introduce you to our next lecturer. It's Dr. Manjir Samanta Laughton. Okay. Now, there's lots of things I've written down about her, but what you need to know is that she's the best-selling author of the book Punk Science, and she is also one of the world's top experts on black holes. But her perception of black holes, excuse the pun then if you'll appear later, is entirely different to what mainstream science offers us. And her vision of it not only changes our vision of the creation of matter, quite literally, but it also gives us a whole new insight into the origins of civilization. So without further ado, I'll pass you over to Dr. Manjir.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me here today as well. And I know that we've got a lot to pack in just 1 hour, which is like, a whole PhD thesis. So I'm going to go through this like pretty quickly. Every single slide you could, you know, spend a whole day on. But are you happy with that?
Yeah.
Okay, brilliant. Okay, so what have black holes... Oh, is the sound okay? Is my voice is okay, yeah? Not too loud or high-pitched or anything, yeah? Okay, brilliant. So what have black holes got to do with the origins of civilization? So that's what we're going to be discussing today. And I'm going to do a bit of an overview. There's not many slides with writing on, so don't worry. It's not death by a PowerPoint. Okay, so what are the problems with history when you look in terms of modern physics and modern science? We're going to be looking at that. What are the changes in science and physics which can have a kind of implication with history? I'm going to be looking at this new theory of black holes very briefly, I'm afraid, because there's a lot to do today, but that's the theory that I've been discussing for the last decade. And so we'll get new perspectives from that on time and the great year, etc. And there's also going to be a new explanation of what we know as the flood. So the flood myths that have been occurring all over the world. And so when we look at history, which history as we know it sort of has only existed really for a few hundred years in the way that we think about history. And but we make a number of assumptions. One of those is that space and time have always been the same and they're actually fixed. Yeah, would you agree? That's one of the things that it's something that we don't actually even address because it's so assumed that this is the case. And the time has always been this steady clock in the background. So, you know, what was a year now? What is a year back then? And there's only one plane of reality. Yeah, that's something that we talk about. You know, we just assume these things. We don't actually go into, you know, why we look at these. And the reality that we experience is the same as what the ancients experienced. Now, this is absolutely key. How many in here have had some sort of mystical experience, would you say, or admit to it? Okay. How many of those who talked to their friends were completely skeptical or wouldn't even tell, right, okay, you wouldn't tell your GP, for example, would you? So we know even in our time that there's lots of different perceptions as to what reality is. And the way that we, the sort of reality that we have in our history books and the kind of mainstream view is really just one view. It's like a flat earth view. And really the ancients could have been accessing many other different planes of reality. So what does science really tell us about this? Because science for a long time, we thought that everything is solid. You probably heard of the reductionist Newtonian paradigm, that everything is solid, everything is, the atom is the smallest unit of matter. This is what we thought for a very long time. And the word atom actually derives from the Greek word to be indivisible. So it was, you know, just over 100 years now where this view of reality started to break down in science. And there's one of the people who was involved in this breaking down, J.G. Thompson, and his experiments on finding evidence for an electron. Now, an electron is a subatomic particle. So far from being the atom being the most fundamental aspect of nature, we actually started to look deep into the atom and found that there's lots of empty space and that there are these subatomic particles. And the experiments were done at the time to actually prove this. So this idea that everything is fixed started to really break down just over 100 years ago. And then we entered the era of quantum physics. And as I said, each of these slides could be a whole university degree. The bottom line that I'm going to talk about with quantum theory is that it introduced something called wave-particle duality. So has anybody heard of that? Yeah? Okay, most of it, right, brilliant. A lot of people in this room. So depending on how we measured an experiment, how we observed an experiment, is how reality behaves. And we talk about observation taking a wave function, which is, you can kind of think of it as a map as to where a particle might be. And it is only when we observe it that it actually collapses into a point particle. So this was around the 1930s in Copenhagen and other places where people like Niels Bohr and Heisenberg were doing these sorts of experiments, double slit experiment, etc. And what it really said to us was, we are not divorced from reality. You know, there's something about our observation and our minds and our consciousness that is somehow related to matter. And before quantum theory, the two really didn't mix at all. Our perceptions, our observations, and matter didn't mix at all. So a lot of you probably know about Professor Amit Goswami, and people started to look at what this actually meant. People like Professor Amit Goswami in the States, Elizabeth Rocha, certain physicists actually started to look at, well, what does this mean? What does it actually mean that, you know, when we observe something, it collapses down from this where it might be into where it is? You know, what does it mean? And they started to look at, well, we're told that the brain originates consciousness, but the brain is also made of atoms. So it led to this paradox, which came first, consciousness or the brain. And the way that certain physicists, not all, a very small percentage, started to resolve this in the 1960s is by saying that consciousness is fundamental to reality and that all of matter arises from it. And mainstream physicists are a bit uncomfortable with this. They would rather say information is fundamental, right? So they don't imbue this information with any sort of sentience. We're just starting to transcend that line as well with mainstream physicists as well. Max Tegmark, for example, just recently said from the conclusions of quantum physics, consciousness must be another state of matter. So these are the mainstream scientists, and in science you only have to have one person who's big and clever and got a very important job for everyone to say, oh yeah, we knew that all along. You know, so you know, we're starting to see the change happen. So that's one area in which our reality has started to break down in science. Another area is in something called string theory, which you might have heard of. Now, this became very popular in the 80s and 90s as a sort of theory of everything, something that could bring the all the forces and the particles of physics together. So, you know, before this, I mean, we've got the science of the very large, you know, the gravity that's out there. And then we've got the quantum physics, the science of the very small, and things really haven't been able to be brought together. So people are really looking for what Tom Campbell says, my big toe, you know, the theory of everything. And string theory for a while looked like a good contender for this. But interestingly, string theory talks about the universe made up of vibrations. And excuse me. And depending on how these vibrations actually behave, these give rise to all the different particles and all the different forces of physics that we know about. And this should really have been the end of it. People were hoping that this was the final theory. But they ended up with sort of about how many different versions of string theory, and it wasn't as successful as they were hoping. But the point is, in mainstream physics, you had this idea that fundamental to everything is vibration, and also it introduced the idea of many dimensions. So you had the idea that the universe had many dimensions to it, and that's something that fell out of the mathematics. And at first, people thought that that these dimensions were quite teeny tiny and curled up and we never accessed them. And then the idea was that they were just as rich as our world, and there were many different worlds to the universe. So these are some of the ways that we have broken down these concepts that we had before. And then of course there was Einstein's theory of relativity. And so whereas before we had the idea that time was a constant clock that was ticking away in the background no matter where, what relativity showed is it depends on where you are in the universe as to how space and time behave, how fast you're actually moving. And you know, so there was this big change in this, the ideas that Newton, what's known as Newtonian physics, where you had this universal clock. So what impact did these changes in physics have on the way that we view history and our origins? And really, to sum up all those subjects, which are just absolutely, you know, big subjects in themselves, of course, but really you saw the dissolution of a fixed space, time, and reality. So we're going to go a bit further as well, though, and we're going to talk about the new theory of black holes that, I've been first published in 2003. And I'm a medical doctor, by the way, so you know, so it was a big thing for me to publish this. And but as we'll see, over time, this theory has actually produced many predictions that have come true. So what I published back in the you know, in those years has actually been proved by findings of NASA, etc., in the last few years, and then we'll bring it all together at the end as to what this means for history. So, you know, this unites the quantum, as I was talking about with cosmology, but it also unites the whole cosmos with consciousness. Consciousness being fundamental is the basis of this new theory. And, you know, you'd expect it to unite some fundamental forces. And it also makes some success, as I said, successful predictions and fits the evidence. And which a lot of current cosmology doesn't, by the way. You know, now that we have the telescopes, we can actually say that the evidence that's showing up doesn't actually fit the theories. So it also gives a new explanation of the flood and of time, which we'll go into, and really gives a whole new understanding of ancient people. So at the moment, you probably have heard of something called the Big Bang, where the universe started in a single point of singularity and spread out from there. It's a great idea, but unfortunately it's it doesn't fit with any of the observations. So now we have the actual observations, we're starting to see the concept of the Big Bang breakdown. And if you want to see evidence of the consternation of this, you can go into, I think it was New Scientist in 2003, there was an open letter from a number of cosmologists around the world who actually said, you know, we want to work on something other than the Big Bang because we're seeing that the data does not fit the theory. You know, the evidence we're getting back from our telescopes doesn't fit how the Big Bang should behave. But if you want to know an example of that, yeah? Yeah? Okay. For example, if the Big Bang really happened, then the deeper that we look into space, the more that we should be looking into the past. Because light has taken a certain amount of time to reach us, yeah? So the deeper we look into space, the more that we should be looking into the past because we're looking at old light. Does that make sense? Okay, that's not what we see. Okay, and we are looking at, you know, into the far reaches of space now, to almost the moment of the Big Bang when it should have happened if it was real. And we see the same. We see that the universe looks the same. It has new stars, new old stars, you know, galaxies. You know, you see it the same. It's actually caused Italian physicists to come up with a fractal model of cosmology because everything just looks the same. It's one of the puzzles of cosmology. But undaunted, there was great celebration when cosmologists brought this out. You probably heard of the standard model of particle physics and the Higgs boson and all that sort of stuff. Yeah? So this was the standard model of cosmology that came out, and lots of champagne was released when they got this picture. Because up till then, they felt as if cosmology was not a real science. Because let's face it, you can't experiment with the whole universe. You know, so they were just getting ideas and they weren't getting the actual data. Excuse me. But when they actually started looking with their telescopes, such as the WMAP telescope, they started to get back a picture of the universe, and this is what they got. So the standard model, the sort of current model with a bit of wiggle room, depending on who you're looking at, is that the universe is made of 73% dark energy and about 20% dark matter. And then, you know, this 3.6% is intergalactic gas. And then this 0.4% is what is called stars, etc. So now that 0.4%, that this little etc. includes everything. It includes you. It includes any galaxies we see. Anything that we see that is visible. You know, that is included in this etc. So. Really, you can, even though the champagne came out and this dark energy, we actually don't know what that is, nor do we know what the dark matter is. We can see the effects of these things, but we don't actually know what these things are. And but still the celebrations went on. I mean, yeah, that we know what the universe exists of. Don't really know, and a little bit of this. You know, so it's like, yeah, it's quite strange. So, and you know, the problems went on. You know, the more that we started to look, the more we started to see patterns in the microwave data that were aligned to structures that exist now. So, if this really was the echo of the Big Bang, it shouldn't have any alignments to do with now, because it should actually be reflecting something that happened 15 billion years ago. So why was it showing up our solar system right now? So we started to see things that made us think again. And so mainstream scientists, I don't know if anybody saw this Horizon documentary that said something like, what if everything we know about the universe was wrong? It was called something like that. It was on about 3 years ago now. Does anybody catch that? Yeah, okay. So, I mean, when that happened, a few people were calling me up going, oh, Manjir, you were right, you know, and it was like, okay. Because a lot of people don't know there's a crisis in cosmology, so they don't know there's anything to fix, you know. So, so this programme actually said that we may need to throw everything out and start again.
I think we're at an interesting time where we're up against how perfect a model it might be. Maybe the standard model is wrong and we have to come up with a better model.
Okay, brilliant. So this is Pedro Pereira from Oxford University, mainstream physicist, saying maybe we have to come up with a new model. Yeah, because what was happening is the observations don't fit the data, the evidence doesn't fit the theory. Now, when it comes to science, which is supposed to be based on evidence, that's a bit of a problem. So, not that, you know, if you watch something, a certain TV presenter, you would get that impression. I'm not going to name any names. Okay, but it sounds like an apple. But anyway, yeah, they tend to give you the impression that everything is sorted out and there's no crisis. So the other thing that they found that they weren't expecting at all is that black holes are everywhere. And so the more that they're looking into space, this is totally unexpected, about 15 years ago now, they started to find black holes at the centre of every galaxy, all over the galaxies, and this is a complete surprise. I just played this.
One by one, we were seeing this picture sort of emerge out of the fog, that every galaxy, or almost every galaxy, had a supermassive black hole in it. It was really quite astonishing.
So you can tell by his surprise that this was not what they were expecting, because in their minds, black holes were actually, you know, the end point of stars, the collapse of stars that were just, you know, beyond the Chandrasekhar limit, it's called. So beyond a certain size, the old stars, when they reach the end of their life, collapse in on themselves into a singularity, and you end up with this great guzzling monster that sucks up everything around it. So this is like an artist's depiction of the old picture of black holes, which is, you know, you've got this sort of star falling down the plug hole, and as it's falling down the plug hole, it emits these jets, the black holes emitting these jets. So that's the kind of old picture that we have. Now, if that's really the case, then we shouldn't be seeing them everywhere, because they should be quite rare events. And so what are they doing at the centre of every single galaxy? Now, at this point, you would have thought that they started to wonder if the black holes had something to do with creating the galaxies, even though they were in the centre of all of them. But, you know, still, if you talk to some physicists, they still talk about black holes being destructive. So, you know, the more that we looked, the more that we saw a different picture. And did you know also that there's a direct relationship between the supermassive black hole at the centre of a galaxy and the actual size of a galaxy? Did you know that? Yeah, so it plots one-to-one, it's absolutely perfect. You know? So again, the penny wasn't quite dropping at that point. And we did actually go through a middle stage in cosmology where people started to talk about co-evolution. Because they weren't quite ready to let go of this old picture of black holes, that black holes were destructive. Yeah. But they knew that black holes must have something to do with creating galaxies. So they had to have this middle stage. So the reality is that we see quite a lot of stuff coming out of black holes, because at the end of the day, why are black holes called black? Because they're supposed to suck out of everything around them, even including light, that light can't escape. But actually, we can see them because they're actually really bright. They actually emit an awful lot of material. So I was kind of like pondering this, going, why is it that black holes actually emit all of this material? How bizarre. That's exactly the opposite of what we're told. And what sort of material are they actually emitting? Well, they're emitting electrons, which are this is something called a microquasar. So this is not only are black holes at the centre of galaxies, but they're all over galaxies as well, in lots of different sizes. So the sort of things that we see coming out of black holes are electrons, which are matter, you know, are almost at the speed of light, that's been emitted. Positrons, which are antimatter, we see those coming out. And we see gamma rays as well. And we see these happening, sort of these fluctuations, this sort of, you know, sometimes we see more of the other, sometimes we see gamma rays. Now, gamma rays are light at a different part of the spectrum, than the visible spectrum. So it was a bit of a puzzle. Now, as you do, I kind of went out for a walk in the woods. This is the infamous incident in 2003. And I just sat on the branch of an oak tree, and it actually all came together for me. And I suddenly saw how to fit it all together. And, you know, I'll fit it all together, the science I talked about in the middle, in the beginning. So, first of all, you have to get used to this concept that the speed of light is not the speed limit of our universe at all. Okay, so the speed of light is the limitation of what we call the 3D universe, the matter universe. Okay, so it's because the physicists think that that's all there is to the universe, things that they can measure, you know, they think that that's the limit. When actually, and this is tied in with some mainstream physics concepts like variable speed of light theory, where some mainstream physicists actually have been saying light is infinite. It makes more sense mathematically. This is mainstream physicists at Imperial College. Light is infinite, and it just expresses itself at different dimensions. Yeah, does that make sense? It's a bit of a hard concept to... So, you know, it, depending on where you are in the universe is how fast you see light travelling. Does that make sense? Okay. So, when we're talking about our 3D world, you know, that when we're talking about anything that is made of matter, that can't go faster than the speed of light. That still goes true. But not everything in the universe is matter, you know. So, you know, you have something called consciousness. What is that exactly? You know, so what I was saying is that we have to rethink our universe to realise that, you know, what we call the speed of light is simply, and you alluded to this, the perception horizon. Okay, that's a limitation of our normal 3D perceptions. Okay, and there's actually a lot beyond that. These are the sort of beyond the perception horizon, the realms of the mystics, you know, the realms of the visionaries. And if anybody has meditated, you do see this brilliant light that's not like anything that you've known before. So this is the realm of what we normally call dark matter and dark energy. It's actually not dark, it's super bright. So, but we, in our 3D limitation perception, just think that the speed of light is the speed limit of the universe. There's a lot more to it. I'm just really, really going through this very, very quickly. But is everybody happy with that so far? Yeah. So suddenly you can reframe the black hole to realize that, just as we see in our telescopes, the black hole actually is emitting material, because what a black hole is actually the, at the centre is still the singularity. It's the infinite light. And if you want the infinite light of consciousness, and but we'll leave the consciousness out for a second. And then it spirals, the light spirals through the dimensions from the infinity, and it gets to the edge of our reality. What I've just redefined as a perception horizon. And when it gets to that edge, what happens is that particle of light splits into a particle of matter and a particle of antimatter, which are the two mirror images of each other. Yeah? And when the particle of light splits, a particle of light is like massless, a photon is massless. when it splits, that's when it gets the mass and the charge, or all the things that we associate with matter and antimatter. But they're actually two halves of light that have actually sort of split below this perception horizon. Does everybody understand that? Yeah? No? Okay, we'll go over that again. So, you know, when the light gets to the edge of our reality, which is, as we normally call it, the speed of light, the particle of light actually splits and it turns into the electron, which is a matter aspect of reality, which makes up our world. That's the world that we're used to, the world of matter. But there's also a particle of antimatter created, okay? And those two particles are like mirror images of each other, and they are also sort of two halves of light, as it were. So it splits in two, and that's what's created. Now, that's why we see electrons coming out of black holes at just under the speed of light. So this fits with the observations. Science is nothing if it hasn't got evidence and making predictions that come true. So this is actually why we see electrons just at 95% the speed of light coming out of black holes, because they've only just slowed down to our reality. So we see them coming out of nowhere. They're actually the result of a higher dimensional process. Does this make sense? Okay. So, and there's so much to go through, so I think we have to leave the antimatter till a bit later. So we also see the antimatter coming out as well. Now this is actually a real picture of a galaxy from the Hubble Space Telescope. And one of the signatures of this kind of creation process is these bipolar jets. Now, a lot of people get worried at this point because they think, I mean, that they're manic depressive, but I don't really mean that. So it's there's these two poles, can you see it, 180 degrees to each other. Now, I have been in physics conferences to just check that I've got all the evidence and everything correct. And obviously a lot of it went over my head, I'm not a physicist, but I sat in a lecture with a guy who was doing the most utmost contortions mathematically to try and explain why these bipolar jets are occurring at the angle that they're occurring. Because if you look at the old picture of black holes, if anything comes off it, it should be, you know, like a Catherine wheel has sparks on the edges. Yeah, so the old picture of black holes is that the emissions are coming off because the stuff is going, like a star that's been sucked in or whatever, is going around so fast and being heated up so fast, that's why you get the material coming off it. Now, if you speak to scientists, they'll still tell you this. Okay, but, you know, the actual reality of it, they don't know why it should look like this. They have to do tremendous mathematical contortions to get it to do this. So what they're doing is they're actually seeing the observation, they didn't predict it, so they then have to backtrack, make really, really sort of contorted efforts to try and make it all fit. And then they say, we knew it all along. You know, so that's their scientific process at the moment. And it happens quite a lot. So, I'm just thinking if I can think of another example of that, but we'll go into some later. So, and the other thing about the black holes is they're actually kind of breathing. So they actually, if you can see, this process is happening all along. This particle of light, the photon, which is not showing up, but anyway, oh, there we go, is actually splitting into the positron electron and then goes back into the photon again, yeah? At the event horizon. So this constant cycling is happening. So sometimes we see electrons being emitted, and sometimes we see gamma rays, photons in the form of gamma rays. What do we see all over the universe? Gamma ray bursts. So, and they're periodic. They happen in, sorry, I'm trying to use the microphone so it doesn't pass so much. They're periodic and they happen in seemingly random patterns. Sometimes we'll see a gamma ray burst that will go on for even several days. and then sometimes we'll just see a flash. And the idea that they have the moment is that these are explosions. Well, if they're explosions, then they should explode and then die away. That's not what we see. We see what's called gamma ray burst repeaters, which is another example of scientists don't understand what it is, so they give it a nice label. So, so these are called gamma ray burst repeaters. So we see them all over the sky. We see these oscillating patterns which don't fit the concept of an explosion. So we see gamma rays and we see X-rays. X-rays are produced by electrons. And so we see this constant pattern, and scientists at the moment don't really know why it is. Now, bear in mind, I first published this in 2003 and published my book in Punk Science in 2006. And in that book, I said we should find gamma ray bursts coming out of the Milky Way. Well, I said, actually, we do find that the early signs were. Now, in 2010, this is what they found coming out of the Milky Way. Two giant bubbles of gamma rays. Does everybody remember this? And the headline was, the universe, is, the galaxy is blowing bubbles. And this was completely unexpected from their perspective. But from our perspective, from the black hole principle perspective, this was completely expected. And can you see these two jets? Okay, so as the jets are circling, so the creation process is happening there at the center of the galaxy, and as these jets are circling, they're creating these bubbles, yeah? Okay, so in their minds, this can only happen as if there's an explosion. You know, they don't understand the high-dimensional processes that are going on beyond normal consciousness, beyond normal perception, beyond normal measurement, that is producing the end result of these gamma ray burst spirals. Okay, so they're looking at a flat Earth perspective, effectively. And so they're seeing the end result, and they're trying to explain it in terms of violence, constantly about violence. You know, so you see this, and this was completely unexpected. And a few years on, there was an article just recently, they admitted they still don't know why our own galaxy has these gamma ray burst bubbles. Gamma ray bubbles, okay? So it's not just out of space, though, that you get these patterns. It's a fractal of all the way down. This is the same pattern all the way. And I could go on seriously all day about this, but obviously we're limited for time. So there are black holes occur, the same principle happens at every single level. Now, first glance, this looks like it's another galaxy, doesn't it? And actually, this is a young star. So the same bipolar jets happen from young stars. Can you see that at the bottom? From brown dwarfs, and they don't really understand why. Because in their paradigm, young stars and brown dwarfs should not have the power, that's old stars and new stars, should not have the sort of power to produce these sort of jets. So, to bring that right home, solar flares fire off antimatter particles. Now, didn't I say earlier that antimatter was produced in part of this process? Do you remember that? I know it's a lot to take in, but so this is 2013. If you see, this was completely unexpected again. They found antimatter in solar flares. Okay, so this is, again, not something that they were expecting, but totally predictable from this theory. Once you understand the basic pattern, you can start making these predictions, and that's what's a powerful theory in science, if it makes successful predictions. Again, it happens around planets. You see these flares that are happening, and people don't understand why, because Jupiter's supposed to be too far away from the Sun to be producing these flares. It's happening because Jupiter, any planet, is effectively a black hole dynamo that's producing its own emissions, periodic emissions. Okay, and now you see Saturn changing its rings because these fluctuations are periodic. It goes all the way down to the atom. So this is actually a New Scientist cover talking about black holes being inside of us, and atomic black holes. So it's not out of the realms of mainstream science. A bit of a scary picture, that. but again, what you see in radioactivity, for example, is you see gamma rays and you see beta particles, electrons, being emitted. So the same principle sort of happening all the way around. I won't go into the alpha particles just for time's sake. So, and then, you know, the chakras. You know, this is something much derided by scientists, but are chakras the same process? You've got these spirals of these vortices that are creating the body. So it's the same pattern that goes all the way down. Okay, and so is the Earth a black hole? Well, surprisingly, we've got quite a lot of evidence. And this is probably something you're quite familiar with, and the concept of lightning. Now, lightning is very, very fast moving electrons. Now, we are told that lightning is created by charge building up in clouds. Anybody heard that one? Yeah, okay. Now, they've done the experiments and they found that this is impossible because there's not enough charge that builds up during a storm in the clouds. There's not nearly enough. But this is what they still have in the textbooks, rather than admit they don't know what's going on. Now, interestingly, in the satellite era, we are able to look above the clouds. And what we have found are, effectively, gamma ray bursts. Yeah, in the Earth's upper atmosphere, just as powerful as a black hole's out in space. Okay, so, and they are associated with storms. So, with thunderstorms. So, in a storm, you get gamma ray bursts, you get lightning, which are fast-moving electrons, yeah, same as a black hole out in space, out in the centre of galaxies. They're basically storms, are mini black holes in the Earth's upper atmosphere. Okay, so we see more and more evidence. Now, if I'm right, what else should we see? Yay! Someone got it right! So, and what happened? 2011, NASA catches antimatter coming from thunderstorms. So, you know, the power of the theory is to make predictions, and again, they don't understand why, but this is just the funniest thing. We know in detail how black holes work at the center of galaxies, but we don't understand what's going on inside thunderclouds just a few miles above our heads, which is hilarious because they don't understand they're the same. Okay, and volcanoes, what do we get out of those? Lightning. You know, they're periodic emissions that are producing fast-moving electrons. The plumes that come out of volcanoes are also spiraling, yeah, which is a whole subject in itself about the spiral. But coming back to the thunderstorms, what else do we get in a thunderstorm? We got rain. And I was quite surprised when I started looking into this that meteorologists, this is a quote from New Scientist, that they don't understand why some clouds rain and some clouds don't. They actually don't understand the process of rain. And I was told that everybody else in school that you have a little cloud and it goes up the hill and it releases it water, everything like the water cycle. But actually, if you look at this, they fudge the inner mechanisms of clouds. You know, so this is quite major. We don't actually know why it rains. So I was thinking to myself, if thunderstorms are black holes in the Earth's upper atmosphere, then there's only one conclusion. Black holes have to produce water. And I thought, everyone's going to think I'm completely nuts. They think I'm nuts anyway, but I mean, you know, everyone's going to think I'm completely nuts. And then, you know, partly James actually came to me like a few months ago and said, I found this. And basically, we found this news that black holes have been found to emit jets of water. Okay, so, you know, this is the sort of big news, and we'll bring it right back to the flood. You can see how this is all coming together now, yeah? I'm sorry. Don't mean to startle you like that. Okay, so that was the big news. So black holes actually have jets of mazes, what they call mazes, which is microwaves of water, H2O, you know, coming directly out of black holes. So that is the big shock news. And so if I'm correct, we should see the same process happening everywhere. Because if I'm saying everything is the same mechanism, we should see water coming out everywhere. And yep, this is in the news at the moment, Rosetta. The comet actually produces a lot of water, jets of water. Water found at the moon's north pole. Water even coming out of sunspots. You know, even, I mean, crazy. And of course, the famous ash cloud. Volcanoes actually emit mostly water. The ash cloud in Iceland a few years back was actually not created by burning trees because there aren't any trees in Iceland. You know, it was actually mostly water vapor, 60% water vapor. So in 2013, I was at the Institute of Noetic Sciences speaking there. And I was speaking in front of Edgar Mitchell, the astronaut, etc. And I actually put this to the audience there because there's a big question as to how water got to the Earth. Was it a comet? Was it or an asteroid or something? But people thought there's not really enough water on an asteroid to actually bring enough water to sustain this planet with water and with all the oceans. And so it's been a big mystery. And I made this prediction that the water comes out of the center of the planet because the center of the Earth is also a black hole dynamo. So it has the same, so the oceans are actually coming from, you know, the Earth's interior, which we know very little about, by the way, very little. If you hear that it's a molten iron moving around, it's just a guess. You know, you might as well talk about fairies at the bottom of the garden because they're more existence of that. Right, so, sorry. So, I wasn't expecting to be proved right within a year, but earlier this year, the news came through of a massive ocean discovered towards the Earth's core. Okay, so suddenly we've had this turnaround in the last few months that the water from the planet, just as I predicted, comes from the Earth's core, not from outside of the planet. Okay, is everyone happy? Yeah, okay. So bringing it right around to ancient history now, oh, at last. we have a new explanation that I'm putting forward for the flood, you know, for the ancient, because a lot of people say the flood could not have happened because it's just too, there's not enough water. There wasn't enough water from the glaciers, there wasn't enough water on the planet to have suddenly have flooded the Earth like that. But when you understand that water comes from the periodic ejections of the central black hole of the planet, and that what is actually fundamental to everything, all of these ejections, is changes in the fundamental consciousness at the center of the black hole, then it's actually pulses of consciousness that are coming from the center of the planet that that are, as they pulse out, you get the release of water. And sometimes there's a big release, like a release of, like a quantum leap. So what I'm proposing is the flood myths of which we have all over the place is because water itself, which is an extraordinary substance, if you look at the work of Professor Gerald Pollack, is actually coming through from higher dimensions. And actually coming through, when it manifests in our dimension, it's the molecule that we're familiar with. But this is why it's been seen, the evidence is everywhere, that it's actually coming out. Even there's the biggest pool of water ever found in space right now. They've found a massive, massive pool of water. And it's funny when they actually report on this, because they just talk about it, and then they go, okay, there it is, because it was so unexpected to find this stuff. doesn't fit their theories at all. But if you understand that the same process going on in thunderstorms is the same at the centre of a galaxy, this all starts to make sense. So what I'm putting forward is that the flood was created by a massive ejection of water from the central black hole of the planet, probably due to a change in the fundamental nature of consciousness itself. Okay, is everyone happy with that? No? Controversial, I know. If you go back to your creation myths, in this room, people will know a lot of those. You'll see that they often talk about the waters of chaos. You know, water is everywhere. The gods came from the waters. If you look back, you will see water described in the same way that is kind of not so familiar to us. So what I think these ancient people and indigenous cultures as well are talking about is the understanding that water exists in different states other than the one that we're familiar with. It's more fundamental to reality than we ever thought before. And I do recommend the work of Professor Gerald Pollack as well, to look at how his experiments and how extraordinary water is and how puzzling it is. It doesn't behave in the way that you'd expect. So the other thing that I think the black hole gives us, the black hole principle gives us, is a new version of time, because I've just given you the proof that, some evidence for, not the proof, but the evidence for the black hole principle going throughout all of the cosmos, and it also being a mechanism by which we have been able to make some predictions that have been proved by NASA and various bodies. So is time also a spiral? You know, I started off by saying space and time doesn't behave in the same way that we've always thought. You know, we've broken down this idea of reality being solid by several mechanisms, relativity, string theory, quantum physics, all of those things. So when you look at, this is, you know, an example, I wouldn't say that this is the actual, way that it is, but, you know, perhaps what we're going through is a sort of spiral of time, is a sort of cycle. Well, we would see the spiral as a sine wave, as a kind of sine wave. And we've known for many years, and in many different societies, people talked about the great year, the 26,000 cycle, or whatever, whichever way you look at it. So what I'm proposing is that history behaves differently because space and time behave quite differently. And I'm putting forward something called the accordion effect, where what we have, just like the bellows of the accordion, is you have space and time, the dimensions, starting off sort of together, then they go apart, like the veils become thicker, as it were, and then they come together again. And through the cycles of time, you see the splitting of the dimensions. You go from the golden ages to the dark ages and back again. And the dimension, space and time itself, changes. And you end up, because we've seen by our modern physics that space and time is not fixed. You know, we have to leave that behind, that there's a clock ticking, that history is always as it was, and that our reality is the same as the ancients' reality. You know, we have to leave that behind. That's impossible to say by modern physics. So this is a rough schematic of how it might be. So, you know, you have at the height of the spiral, as it were, the Golden Age, and this is a kind of era of kind of Lemuria and that type of idea. And at that point, we were probably light bodies. I don't know if anybody else, I've had this experience, has gone into the light body world. Has anybody had this experience? It's not that, of course, some people, yeah. So if you're a mystic as I am, you know, you not only talk about these things, you experience them. So these levels actually exist all around us, just as string theory is saying. There's different levels of consciousness. So you have these realms that were originally in light bodies. So perhaps we don't see the archaeological remains of these areas, because they weren't physical in the way that we know it. They weren't in space and time. They weren't below the speed of light. So we can't use below the speed of light measurement instruments to try and uncover them. So that's the sort of golden age. And if you have had any mystical experience of this, people speak in telepathy. It's an exchange of consciousness. Everything is very much balanced. And you can't even have the thought of a negative thought, because anything like that will just take you straight back into your body, you know, if you're currently in physical. So, and this is probably the height of sophistication for where it all comes. So again, this is very rough. Then we had a sort of intermediate period. And I think this is where we had, I'm calling hybrid slightly different, because I think a lot of what we call the gods were interdimensional beings. And when the dimensions were closer together, like the bellows of the accordion, that's when we get all the stories of people interacting with the so-called gods a lot more than they do now, you know, although that is changing. So this is when the dimensions started to split. And so when you get, I'm calling the god-human hybrids as well. And what we see in a lot of ancient texts, such as, I mean, even the Bible said this, when the sons of God comes to the daughter of man, they produce a giant. You know, so, and we have this in a lot of the Greek texts, you know. So perhaps what was happening is interdimensional beings were starting to, as the space and time was starting to come down the spiral, there was a mixing for a while. And I don't know if you've read the bit of the Book of Enoch where the angels were told, don't have sex and don't eat. Does anyone notice the don't eat bit? Right? Because anybody who's had any interdimensional experience knows one thing. If you do that sort of thing, you're grounded. You ground yourself. And what happens after they do these things, they get stuck. So it's not the sex that they were punished for particularly. It's because they grounded themselves. Yeah, so, you know, this absolutely fits with interdimensional experiences. So this is where, why civilization has gone from highly civilized to down again. Because what we were having here were the memories of the previous light bodies and the previous high civilizations. This is where you get the long lifespans, you know, the patriarchs that were living for 900, the king's lists of Berossus and Manetho that were saying that the kings were just living there before the flood, amazing, amazing long lifespans. Because space and time were not the same. Does that make sense? Modern historians and stuff, they just discard that. Oh, they were hallucinating, you know, but I mean, they were just making up, or it was a metaphor for great men. You know, why would anybody put a metaphor that's so specific? You know, like 943 years or something. It's like what we're seeing is we're making the assumption that space and time is the same as we currently experience it. You know, but when we start to realize that physics has changed, space and time is not fixed, that we can start to look at the pre-flood in a different way, and realize that the flood itself was a major black hole ejection of the Earth, which was a major consciousness shift, and therefore a fall down the spiral. Okay, and that's why so much water could be created, because it's coming in from different dimensions. So, 5 minutes left. So there we go, the flood due to consciousness shift. Then we come into the sort of dark age, which you could argue that we're still in. To a certain degree, where we're materialistic, the higher dimensions are completely forgotten. We look back at the ancient texts of gods and things like that and just assume that they were making this up. Just, we don't see from the same perspective, you know. And so contact with the gods at this point, or the interdimensional beings, is happening. Joan of Arc, that sort of person, but it's minimal and it's ridiculed. You know, any interdimensional contact is ridiculed, or experience of any sort. And then we're starting, this is the era that we're coming into now, where people are starting to wake up mystically. And we're actually having the same sort of thing happen where people are starting to have connections with higher dimensional beings. It's starting to come in. There's a huge interest in angels and this sort of thing. So we're going back to an ascension to the golden age there. So in summary, I think I've done okay with time, I don't know. Space and time not fixed, as I said. Black hole principle, a new explanation for flood and time. Reality changes according to where you are on the spiral of time. And we're giving an ancient origin, a new perspective with modern science. Ancient people inherited their information from higher dimensions. And I think all of these were, the intermediate levels of the dimension splitting. You know, people like the snake people, the giants, the human hybrids, this is as we're coming down through the dimensions. So sometimes we have physical evidence and other times we don't, depending if it's light body, beyond the speed of light, or if it's lower. So this is the intermediate picture. And as I said, the Book of Enoch says, do not eat food, because, you will get stuck in lower dimensions. A higher dimensional being will get stuck if it takes something that's too grounded, if it does something that's too grounded. Okay, so the dimensions split, but they still exist. Actually, all these beings are all around us all the time. It's just harder to see them when you're in the Dark Age. They're actually everywhere. Lemuria is still there. It's everywhere. It's in this room. It's just like different dimensions. And if you've ever had such an experience, you know that everything is an overlay. It's one of the biggest secrets, because if people cotton onto this too much, you're not going to consume anything. You're not going to be, if you know that this reality ain't all there is, and that's why they keep giving you all these psychic horror films and everything like that, because they want you to be afraid of your own divinity, of your own interdimensional abilities. So they want to shut that down. Hence, shamanic drugs are always outlawed as well. So ancient origins are not physical in the way that we would normally know, although that's changing as we're getting more and more people waking up mystically. And that's due to the summary of science. And can I do a little advert as well? just to sum up. So if anybody wants to know more, I'm just about to release a couple of online courses, one to do with the genius groove. Called Simply Divine's Easy Guide to Science and Spirituality. My website is paradigmrevolution.com or punkscience.com, and we've also got next year the Punk Science movie coming out, so that's punkscience.com.
This is a wonderful time in our history right now, because we're changing the basic paradigms of science.
We are saying the universe works differently to how we previously thought. We're saying that consciousness is at the heart of the universe, and we don't need permission. This is in your face. This is something that is breaking through the old paradigm, and that's really the spirit of punk science.
Punks are the ones who challenge the authority.
I mean, I can't believe it that physicists would actually entertain such a ludicrous speculation.
Big Bang did not happen.
Science is shifting now.
East and West are kind of coming together.
The new ideas are actually coming outside of academia.
Black holes.
Black holes.
The black hole.
Black holes.
Black holes.
Black holes are actually creative. They're actually the creative sources of the universe.
Black holes play a fundamental role in the universe on all scales, from the very largest to the very small.
Black holes are absolutely fascinating.
We're actually living in a black hole.
It's the breathing system of the whole of the multiverse, and without black holes, there is nothing.
It's a paradigm which understands consciousness.
Consciousness is an actual something.
Consciousness is recognized as the primary being.
Not only is it the supporting foundation, it is everything.
But this has huge implications for science.
I think that the implications really are vast.
All that we call reality is consciousness.
Everyday waking awareness is a very thin slice of a much, much larger and multidimensional picture.
What about breaking the light barrier?
Now, the speed of light is pure movement.
What we call the speed of light is pretty much the outer range of this construct.
That the physical body is just a manifestation of the super energy body.
The energy is also representing information.
The body is simply energy. It's simple as that. And technically, it's not even energy so much as consciousness.
We're now on the threshold of an even greater, even more radical revolution in our understanding, not just of the physical world, but the entire nature of reality.
It will ultimately become the new idea.
For people to really come to understand themselves and to love themselves and see others as themselves and see us all part of a larger whole.
And I think I'm supposed to be going out to sign some books as well, Punk Science and the Genius Groove, outside after that. So thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed that.
Thank you, Dr. Manjir.
So I'm Jane Corbett, and I work in the field of leadership development, really working on working deeply with the leader within.
My name's Carolyn Bond. I'm a kindergarten teacher.
Yeah, I'm Ray Savage. I'm a former intelligence officer with the British Police.
Hi, my name's Andrew Collins.
Hi, Laurent here. I'm a filmmaker.
My name's Matt. I come from a physics background. I did a physics degree.
My name is Huffthorpe.
My name is Margaret Novakovic.
I'm Maggie Rackerson.
Hi, I'm Stephen Thomas.
I've met Manjir a couple, 3 years ago and heard her speak before, but I've never heard such, in an hour, such a beautiful extrapolation of everything scientifically, from cosmology right the way through mysticism to where we are today and where we're going. It's just, I implore anybody that gets the opportunity of actually listening and hearing her just complete theory virtually of everything put together so eloquently and so beautifully, and I really am so grateful to have been here today and heard that. Thank you.
It helped unify a lot of the understanding that I have of what I'm experiencing day by day and what's unfolding as we make this journey together. It was very, very exciting and energizing and sort of very simply and elegantly presented, but very, very profound at the same time. I took a lot of notes because it's paradigm shifting and I haven't yet quite assimilated it all. Things like how do light and water connect, but the bit about it's fractals all the way down, I'm absolutely with it, and it's the most powerful way of exploring that I've ever seen. So I really salute you, Manjir, for what you've done and the courageous journey you must have been on over the past decade or so. Let's stay connected.
It was an extraordinary experience of discovering something completely new at the same time as feeling like I was actually remembering something that I knew all along, which was amazing. I'm not a scientist, so to have had it explained in such a way as I could understand it, I think was a phenomenal achievement. I'm particularly excited because I did my Steiner training here at Steiner House, and actually Manjir helped make sense of some of the things that Steiner spoke about to do with consciousness that I'd never understood before. And she's just made me feel like, you know, we're on the threshold of an extraordinary moment where science and archaeology and history, everything is sort of converging And I feel incredibly excited and inspired, so thank you.
I was greatly impressed by the level of her research and her insight into the science, but also her insight into the other side of things, the right brain side, the creative side, and the side from which some of us are interested in, the occult and the mystic side. Well, we've got the real science to prove it now, because out of black holes come photons and antimatter and matter. But what we're now finding is also light at much faster than light speed, and water and other items that make up the physical universe come out of that higher reality, into our reality, our level of perception, and bring into being our physical existence.
She's laid out a whole framework of how consciousness manifests itself into our physical reality, and she lays out a theory about how we can overcome some of the big gaping black holes of problems in science. And she's connected somehow just about everything all together in 1 hour, and it's amazing how she's done it, and it's left me speechless. And what was particularly amazing is that every single concept she was describing, everything from the spiral, particularly the spiral, the infinite spiral at the center of the black hole, or the black hole, going through infinity and then coming down and slowing down and coming into the physical and then manifesting into matter. Everything she describes is the essence of free energy technologies. And I just spoke to her about that, and we made the link there. And it's absolutely clear, the essence of what she is describing is also the essence of the free energy technologies and where technology is going to be moving towards in the future. And that's very exciting.
Yeah, my name's Matt. I come from a physics background. I did a physics degree. And I think the thing that really struck me was that during my physics degree, everything was always trying to fudge the numbers and things, and it was always trying to sort of almost make excuses for the things that didn't fit. And what really struck me today was that everything did fit and you didn't have to fudge anything. It just all seemed to come together nicely.
We have to reassess and reconsider so much of this that we thought had been explained.
I think it's absolutely amazing. I think she's stumbled upon something completely revolutionary, and it links in with so many ancient myths and ancient knowledge. Especially, I think, in terms of Vedic cosmology, it describes the universe exactly and the creation exactly the way she describes it. But she's describing it in terms of physics, but in a very amazingly new way, never heard before. It's absolutely fantastic.
I was absolutely bowled over by it. To me, it was revelatory. I thought she explained everything extremely clearly, and the whole explanations that she gave tied in with all the information I previously had that I hadn't quite fitted into place. So I rushed straight out after the lecture, bought 2 copies of her book, and I plan to go on the websites.
We don't have to believe a lot of the nonsense we are told and fed by the scientists. I think there's a great deal to be learned from Dr. Manjir's work, and I highly recommend anyone to listen to it and read about it.
Hi, my name's Andrew Collins. I've just come from Dr. Manjir's incredible lecture that she's just given at Origins 2014. Her vision of black holes changes everything we know about not just the origins of civilization, but the origins of the cosmos as a whole, and how the whole thing comes together, and how the black hole is basically the origins of creation itself.